am Cassandra Murray of Cassandra's Champions, and welcome to the LMS Show. Here's your host, Lenny Matthews.
Wait. Ooh, big diamond ring on. Nobody gives away diamonds nowadays, except you go upstairs and ask the Lord. You'll get a diamond. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, today, TC Spelling is going to tell you 31 days of the waiting room right here on the LMS Show. Take it out. And welcome back to the LMS Show. Oh my goodness. What we got here? Oh my goodness. Mission Unstoppable. George Frazier. Big gentleman talks about networking. We must network with each other. Met him at the Circle of Sisters a couple years back. You know, the funniest thing, the place should have been full. But when we came out to gossip, everybody was there. Well, what can I say? As Opie said on Eddie Griffin, when we were writing nice, we were writing nice stuff, people didn't want it. But when you're writing gossip, everybody wants it. Well, we welcome you back. And George Frazier and Les Brown, this young lady had the pleasure of meeting with these two gentlemen. I met her here at Sisters. She's going to tell us this story. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. This is Jessica Robinson. Jessica Robinson, how are you?
I am great. Thank you so much for having me, Mr. Matthews.
It's my pleasure. Tell us how you met George Frazier and Les Brown.
Well, I met George Frazier. He has a conference, the Power Networking Conference, that he does every year. And I had been on his mailing list for a number of years, and I was on his mailing list. And prior to his conference every year, he does a series of phone calls. And he sent out an email back in 2012, and he asked people if they were interested in co-authoring a book with him. And if they were, to get on a call with him. And so I responded to that email, and I got on a call. And over the process of the next 2 years, he chose individuals to participate on this project with him, and the book came out last year in 2014. And then that was George, and then throughout the process, in 2013, I believe it was, Les became part of the project as well. Mm-hmm. And it was an opportunity for them, who were, they knew each other, were friendly friends. It was an opportunity for them to work on a project together, and it was a wonderful experience. So it was my opportunity to meet George and work with him on this project, and then through George, I met Les.
Are they men? You know, you have some people go out, you know, who are motivational speakers, and but sometimes, how are they behind the scenes?
That's a great question. I can say that for both George and Les, what you see is what you get. George Frazier is someone who talks about the importance of networking, supporting Black communities, supporting Black businesses, and keeping money within Black communities, and it's exactly what he's talking about.
Sometimes it disgusts me sometimes, what I see, like within our own community, everybody else got a piece of us except us.
Yeah.
The only thing that we get a piece of is nonsense, and we don't control that.
Yeah, no, you're right. And that's why he wanted to do this, because he really wanted to be able to support Black entrepreneurs, and that's also why he does this conference every year. And he's someone who is extremely open, he's extremely gentle, he is someone who is, I think, extremely courageous. He's someone who supports people, particularly in my experience, throughout this entire process. And it was such an honor to be a part of this with him. And Jordan, Les is the same way. Les is so inspirational and motivating. Just to be in his presence was really an honor. And he too was just incredibly supportive. He takes the time and like George to sit down and talk with you and see just how they can support you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. Why they picked your story? I mean, there's a lot of people that said, why your story is picked?
Yeah. So I'm someone, just throughout my journey, I stand for freedom, I stand for safety, and I stand for inclusion. And I'm someone who truly believes that, and uses my gifts as a messenger, as a convener, and also as a teacher to create a more consciously secure world. and, you know, someone who, you know, really focuses on what it means to create a culture of safety, create safe spaces, and someone who has, you know, now I've really dedicated my life to it. I think it was just something different. And they were interested in sharing a story of someone who is, you know, really focuses on living with courage.
What line of business are you in?
I support people in creating safe spaces within themselves, within their communities, and within the world. So I really focus on helping individuals to live their most consciously secure life possible. And so that means walking in authenticity with every single step. So whether you've made a mistake in your life or not, which is what this book is really about, this book is about failures, blessings, people who have truly failed in life, people who you meet and you're like, oh my gosh, you've been through that? I can't believe it. And really helping individuals like that.
What's your experience in life? You know, what was your turning point?
Yeah. Well, you know, the story that I shared and what I talked about was being pregnant at a young age, which is definitely was not easy. And anyone who's been there that's in this room, you know how challenging that is, or you have a partner that was pregnant. And it was about making a choice to be a mother at that point or to not be a mother. And it was extremely challenging, and it was the hardest decision I've ever had to make. And I wanted to share my story because 21% of pregnancies end with a choice to not carry through with the pregnancy. And that's, you know, very, and it's even higher within African American communities. And I wanted people, particularly women, to know that, you know, that you can have an incredible life after that choice, whatever choice that you make, and that you know, you don't have to, you know, it's such a personal decision, and that you don't have to live in, you know, a life that is not whole after that. You know, you can live with courage, you can forgive yourself, you can move on, and you can create a full life after that. And that's what I wanted to share. And so this theory was really about, you know, it was really about the service of sharing, because a lot of people ask, why would you share a story like that? But, you know, I wanted to be able to do it because it is so personal for so many women, and I think it's something that a lot of women can relate to, because it's, if you've ever been there, it's one of the toughest decisions you can ever make.
There were so many people who took part, they say, conscious courage. That was yours, right?
Yes.
Your conscious courage. Yeah. And also, too, in the book, they saying, coming through the book. Okay. And you mentioned about personal freedom. And I think this is kind of important. And what I'm saying, I'm not slamming the education system. But then again, I'm slamming it in a way, too. You mentioned, so I had spent time studying philosophy and spirituality and living incredibly successful men and women who have publicly failed and yet have gone on to have their brilliant success. Reading about people like Walt Disney, Henry Ford, and Albert Einstein, by who all should have never succeeded, gave me hope. Mm-hmm. Is that true?
You know, it is. And so I think you could look at it two different ways. I'm also an entrepreneur. So when you look at someone like Albert Einstein, who didn't speak till he was 4 years old and he was considered dumb by his teachers, Walt Disney, who had failed and so much throughout his early career to the point where he was fired for not being creative enough.
And also, Oswald, I remember he had a rabbit called Oswald the Rabbit, and the people who had it took the copyright away from him.
You know, Ford had no
formal education. He had a third grade education.
Yeah, he didn't even know what Independence Day was for this country. Yeah, he was able to create this incredible company that still runs today. And I think what I was able to learn from them, as, you know, men, and then of course, you know, as white men, and I'm a black woman, is that, you know, there's an opportunity. There's always opportunity. You know, and I think, you know, my biggest heroes are women that have gone through my similar situation that I was able to look to for support, particularly women of color. But as an entrepreneur, looking to those men was something that gave me also hope and inspiration within my own business and moving forward.
I put something in this book, and it's a unique lesson for me to learn, is to have conscious courage. At first, simply see the truth and take responsibility and acknowledge that a different choice could have been made. However, in other situations, it's possible another choice could not have been made. In most cases, in those cases, it's important to forgive yourself and move forward instead of holding on to secrets that will slowly weaken your health or assassinate you. That's including honoring the pains by others, like my family, my boyfriends, and others. What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, and I think no matter what you've gone through in life, if anyone who's gone through something where they feel shame for it, or anyone who's gone through something where they feel failure, if you're going through a yellow light and you hit someone, and it was yellow, so technically you could go, but then you hit someone, it's kind of like, oh my goodness, what did I just do? What just happened? And I think we've all been through situations where we're like, really? Is this really my life? Or did I really get here? And how did I get here? And though sometimes our choices led us there, it's also a recognition of it. You know, if you're in that situation, you're not in it alone. There are people that are there with you. And for me, my family was along with me on this journey. And so for me, it was taking responsibility for getting into the situation that I was in, also the choice that I had to make, but also the ripple effects it had for people around me.
Because it's most important sometimes, I remember Henry Ford mentioned it, sometimes they said it's better to make a decision than to make no decision.
Yes, yes. And when you do make a decision, then it's having the courage, you know, which is why what I contribute is called conscious courage, is having the courage to be able to stay with that and to move forward with it.
Well, I have an enemy, and the enemy is the clock. But there was a young lady you mentioned to me. Tell me about her. What's her name?
Yeah, Nia Reynolds.
Well, tell us about Nia Reynolds. How did you meet Nia Reynolds?
I met Nia through the book project. She has a chapter in the book where she tells her story. And this woman was in a relationship with someone, was upset at the time, and she was driving because I believe he was cheating on her. She believed that he was. And while she was driving, she got very upset, and she got into a car accident. As a result of the car accident, she had scar tissue on her trachea. And at the end of her journey, she actually had to now have a tracheotomy. She now permanently has a pipe that's like literally here and within her throat. And she is one of the most courageous people that I've ever met. And when she talks about her story, she talks about just the importance of loving yourself. You know, and here she was in a car, you know, upset about something that her boyfriend did, which caused an accident, which led to this permanent, permanent hole.
And the family approved that. They said that the family didn't really approve of this guy too much, neither, right?
Mm. Right. No, that's true.
He was a bum, right?
Well, that, you know, to, I'm sure to hear her say it, if she was here right now, I'm sure that she would say, yeah. But I love her story because I think it's so universal, particularly the message that comes from it.
Because when I read, I read the whole book, I remember her story of all the stories in this book, and your story too. And it takes great courage to do this, right?
Yes, oh it does.
How's the book coming along?
The book is doing very well. Went to number one on Amazon, and
give her a big hand.
Seven categories.
Number one.
Continuing to do different book events. There are a number of authors that are involved in the book, and so that's really helped to lead to the success and just having in different communities around the country that are a part of this project.
I'd like to read this to top it off. That dream, you have a mission. That dream you kept on the back burner. You were born to fulfill it. People are waiting for you to take up the charge and see it through. Your mission is bigger than you. Your family needs you. Your community needs you. The world needs you. Mm-hmm. In these pages of this new book, Mission Unstoppable, Extraordinary Stories of Failures, Blessings, renowned visionaries Les Brown and George Frazier team up with 31 successful speakers and business people to give you the courage, the inspiration, and the knowledge you need to complete the mission you were born to fulfill. Gain wisdom, inspiration, and tools for a diverse group of men and women who answer their call and despite obstacles and perception of failure, stay the course and achieve their goals. Folks, your time is now. Tomorrow's not promised.
That's right. And with, you know, what I love about that is that wrapped in within any major experience that you've gone through that has, you know, brought you to your knees or that you truly consider a failure, that's where you'll also find your mission.
No. No, you because you learn something. That's you know, right. You know, every time I do these shows, right. I learn from this show. Right. Believe you me, I learn. Yeah. Learn what to do, what not to do next time.
Yeah, so
to me, it's not a failure.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I love that too. Yeah.
On that note, I'd like to thank you very much for joining today on the LMS show. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Jessica.